have gathered here this morning. It is so good to be with you here in worship this morning. We've had just an incredible few weeks of ministry. I'm actually going to invite Jeremiah up because I want him, before we do anything else this morning, I want him to share about the incredible week that the youth have had on their mission trip this week.
Good morning. So, okay, all right. I like it. So, we went to Bayou Battery, Alabama. And before we went to it, it was Bayou Betray. But when we learned that they pronounced it Bayou Battery, that's what we went with. We were very humid and sticky. And thank you for your prayers, because I survived. I just want to personally thank you, because without your prayers, I wouldn't have. This year, we didn't lose Sam, so that's good. She's tiny, and sometimes we would lose her. But this year, she made it to the van every time on time. So that's something to be thankful for. But seriously, we had a wonderful mission trip where God showed up in many different ways through service projects and the things that we did. You can see some of the pictures that Kyle, with his creation of the church service. And there was a number of wonderful opportunities. And we got to see God break down walls. We got to see God do some amazing things. We gathered together and worshiped with other youth groups, and we went to a local church. We helped do everything from painting to cleaning to working at the Boys and Girls Club for the week. And we had a powerful foot washing service where, you see Annabelle, I'm super happy about her birthday. So we had a wonderful time. And I gotta say, from the bottom of my heart, I am so thankful to be able to lead and to teach and to be in these young people's lives, because they're amazing. And they make me so proud, but they made God's heart so proud, and they got to tap into God's compassion for his people and for his creation. So we're just so thankful, and thankful to you, the members of our family here that made this happen. You made it possible for our kids to experience this, and it's memories that will last a lifetime, and the kingdom of God being advanced through service, work, love, deed, and compassion. So thank you very much, and so I just wanted to say that from the bottom of my heart. We're so grateful to have gone and to come back safely and a wonderful experience. So.
I had the privilege of getting to sit in Sunday school with them and hear stories this morning, and I will tell you, the Lord is at work among these students. It was really incredible just to hear their stories. A couple of announcements. Number one, on Tuesday, we are starting pickleball in the Family Life Center. And I'm very excited about it, and I hope you are too, and that you will join us. Andrew and I will be there. We have been excited to learn about pickleball. I don't really know what it is fully. I know that paddles and nets are involved. So if you want to come learn, you're welcome. It's for all. And then one of these beautiful flowers are for Rich Core's 90th birthday, which is on the 26th. So.
My God and King. join in our opening hymn, number 368, My Hope Is Built.
Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, already. Kind of mixed things up today. Everybody's scattered. All right, so I brought something with me today. Well, a blanket, yes. But how about this? We just came back from camp, and pretty much it was our house. Everybody had one of these, right? Flashlight. Y'all like to play with these when you're a little kid, especially. Or build a fort, or put a blanket under there, and read a book. Like that. Build a Lego or something underneath there. So what does a flashlight help us do? Helps us see. Helps us see, particularly in the dark, right? So what if we turn it on? Helps us see. What if we turn it on with this?
And I'll put it under here.
Does that help anybody?
No.
No, that didn't help.
What if I have it on, but if I get it under here, this, and I got my book, and I got my flashlight, does that help?
Just me, right? Just me. All right. Well, today in our Bible story, Jesus is telling his disciples that they're the light of the world. So he's telling his disciples that they're supposed to be like flashlights and shine God's light and love on everybody, right? And by doing that, they would help everybody around them see God's better way for them to live, right? Make their life good. All right, so Jesus also tells his disciples, he said, don't hide God's light. Don't keep underneath something. Don't keep it all, the good things you know about God, to yourself. You're supposed to let that light shine. So when we were at camp, it's nighttime and it's dark and we're all in our bunks and we're getting ready to go to bed, and there's one girl, got a blanket, she's trying to read, let's do something, I don't know. And then it happens, right? It always can happen a little bit, like, oh, she gets all tangled up and here it goes. Why? Miss Gina, what's that? Who's that? Who has a light? Miss Gina. Somebody has a flashlight. Miss Gina, what's going on? What does she have? What's she doing? Is she reading? Miss Gina. Happens every time, right? They want to know what she got. It's got to be good, right? She's got to be doing something good. So when we invite God into our lives, we receive his light and his love, and that's great for us, right? That's great for us with Jesus in our hearts. We have joy, right? But if we don't share that with other people, then other people will never know how wonderful God's love is. And so when you shine your light, you share God's love with others. And it's not hard, right? Because guess what? It took about half a second for that light to come out, and everybody wanted to know, what's she doing? What's she got? It's a light, right? It's good stuff. What she's got? Guess what she's got? Jesus in her heart right there. All right? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your son, Jesus. We pray we can be flashlights in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you join me in prayer? Mighty and gracious God, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time and this space, Lord, that we have to gather here in your name. Lord, as we continue in worship this morning, would your spirit continue time, make it yours, and that we would be your people, Lord. Bind us up in your spirit and your truth. Make us one heart, one people, Lord, in mission for you. Lord, set our hearts on fire for you. And Lord, would you lead us now in the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We invite you to stand as you're comfortable and join in singing our hymn of faith, number 496. Sweet Hour of Freedom.
Thank you. Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts that you have bestowed upon the Lord. And as we come to you this morning, we give back what is already yours. Lord, we know and we pray, Lord, that you're going to take these gifts and multiply them to bring about your kingdom here. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
morning, standing for the reading of our word. I have to have a confessional moment before I read this. In the first service, I realized my sermon was too long. And so we're going to verse 20 this morning, not 26. So hear the word. I know Jesus did this in one setting, but I'm not Jesus, so we're going to space it out a little more. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside even the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Last week, we kicked off our series on a Sermon on the Mount. And we're going to spend the entire summer on a Sermon on the Mount. Again, I know Jesus did this as one sermon, but he's also Jesus. So last week, we talked about what's known as the Beatitudes. And these Beatitudes, also known as these blessed sayings, were a way for Jesus to start this sermon. And what he wanted us to hear is that we need his grace, we need his love. Jesus preaches this sermon that's all about the kingdom of God. And he starts by saying the kingdom of God is not for the strong, the wealthy, the powerful, but it's actually for those who mourn, who grieve, who are outcasts, who are poor. This is the kingdom of God. So he got some attention. We have to remember that Jesus is teaching his 12 disciples, but there's crowds that have gathered. There's lots of people who have come to listen to Jesus. So today we get into sort of the meat of the sermon. His language begins to change here. And before we get to that, I wanted to read this quote from John Wesley, and he's talking about the Sermon on the Mount. He says this, what is it that he's teaching? The Son of God, who came from heaven, is here showing us the way to heaven, the place that he has prepared for us, the glory he has gone before to show us, his teaching. He is teaching us the true way of life everlasting, the royal way that leads to the kingdom, and the only true way. This is what Wesley says about this sermon, and this is what Jesus is teaching. The way to the kingdom, the way to heaven, the way for faithful living with Jesus. And like we said last week, if you were here, this sermon is not a list of rules for us to follow, but instead Jesus is showing us his kingdom and the nature of his kingdom that's before us. So today we get this even bigger glimpse of what the kingdom of God is, but it starts out a little weird, and he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the world. So he has three main sayings in this text today. You're the salt of the world, you're the light of the world, and I, speaking about himself, Jesus, have come to fulfill the law and the prophets. That's what Jesus is saying in this text. So we start, you're the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the salt of the earth. Not you will be, you could be, you should be, but you are. You are the salt of the earth. Yesterday,
We moved into our home in Forney. We're now Forneyites. Is that right? If I'm walking a little weird, it's because my feet hurt really bad. But I can remember when Andrew and I moved into our first home after we got married a few years ago. And there's a lot that you learn about someone once you're married. I mean, we dated for a long time, but there's just something once you're sharing a space with someone, you learn a lot about a person. And here's what I learned about myself, is that I don't cook as well as I thought I did. I was really proud of my cooking. I love to cook. And Andrew and I didn't really cook together a lot when we were dating, but you know, once you're married, you cook a lot together. And so we would, the first time we cooked together in our home, in our place, we sat down and he took one bite of food, got up, grabbed the salt, and sat back down. Thus began the great salt war between Andrew and I. And what happened was I grew up in a household where we didn't salt our food a lot. There's history of bad blood pressure, and salt just doesn't help that. And so I grew up in a household, we just didn't use a lot of salt. And so the thing about if you don't use a lot of salt, you're really sensitive to the salt. So I just put a little bit, like probably less than a pinch. I always tell you to put a pinch of salt. That's in like every recipe, put a pinch of salt. But I was not even doing that, I guess. So I learned really quickly that I need to salt my food if I want it to be edible, at least for Andrew. And he knows all, apparently he's the expert on salt. That's also what I learned. He's the expert on salt. He's telling me, Hayley, not only does salt flavor the food, because I'm like, so salt's overpowering. And he said, no, it actually opens up your palate so you can actually taste the food better. I didn't know this. Do you know that? I don't know. But that's what he taught me. He also told me that, you know, salt actually brings out the flavor of food, not only because it opens your palate, but something about salt actually brings out the natural flavor in the food so you can taste it better. And I learned through all of his expert knowledge given to me now that I was wrong about the salt. We needed more salt in our food. It's way better. Even with brownies, salt makes brownies better. So I think we're all in agreement that salt's a good thing. So Jesus talks about salt, and salt does a lot of things that we just said earlier, but it also preserves. It was a major preservative back in this time, especially. But salt does a lot of things, and so when Jesus says, you're the salt of the earth, people know what salt is. Even at this time, people know they use it for so many different things. And so he's saying, we are the salt of the earth, meaning we are the people who transform the environment around us. We make it better, we make it what it should be, and we are the ones that are that. Jesus says, you are the ones that are that. And this is the glimpse of the kingdom that we're invited to be a part of. We're invited into the narrative of. He also warns that not to lose the flavor of salt, not to lose the saltiness, not to lose the nature of salt. The Greek word that he uses there is merino, which actually means this loss of taste, but it can also be translated into foolishness. And I think Jesus was aware of this translation when he used this word, because it is in the foolishness, it is in our complacency that we can begin to lose our saltiness, or another way of saying that is lose what it means to be a follower of Jesus. So he's saying, you are the salt of the earth, and don't be complacent. We get this other you are statement, you're the light of the world. He says, verse 14 through 16, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. You are the light of the world. Not you will be, you could be, you should be, but you are. You are the light of the world. That's what Jesus says. Here's the really incredible thing about light. And Gina did like a beautiful illustration of it. Like, we could have just left the sermon there this morning. But even just the littlest flicker of light can shine in a room. even the littlest amount. This morning I got to church early and none of the lights were on. And it was really beautiful just to slowly get to turn on the lights this morning and watch more and more light fill the room. I'll say it's way brighter in here with all of y'all here, because y'all, we are the light, right? We are the light of the world. But Jesus, he's saying this to show that we are called to illuminate the world around us. One Christmas, I think I was in high school, and ladies in the room, my mom got a new makeup mirror, which is a very exciting time in someone's life to get a new makeup mirror. She had one of those that has all the lights around the side, and they had stopped working, so she got a new one, and this was, we named it the Mirror of Truth, because the lights on this makeup mirror were next level bright. All of a sudden, if you sat in front of this mirror, you thought you looked good until you sat in front of this mirror and it revealed all things you did not want to see on your face. It was funny because, so this is around Christmas time, so my sister was in college, so we were all back home, and we couldn't find my brother for a while. My brother is 6'4", this big athletic type, played high school football, and we couldn't find him. And I pushed the bathroom door open, and there he was, sitting in front of the Mirror of Truth, just looking at his face. I mean, you're just enamored by it. I don't know. Anyway, it revealed all things. So there's this thing about light that it not only illuminates, but it reveals. It shows us things that we may have not seen. I don't know about you, but when the lights are dim, or you clean at night, you don't really see things. But when the sun is shining, the lights are on, all of a sudden, there's a pile of dirt I didn't see, or this or that. So light not only shines, but it reveals. And so when Jesus is saying we are to be the light of the world, we are going to shine his light, to bring light into dark places, but also to reveal those places where Jesus' light needs to be, where grace needs to be, where sin is deep. And so Jesus said, you are the light of the world. But we get this warning again. He says, but don't hide it, but put it right in the middle where everyone can see. And that takes boldness, that takes courage to stand out. Jesus in the Beatitudes said, if they make fun of you, it's because of me. So we already know Jesus is saying, you will be an outcast, you will be persecuted. And then Jesus is saying, you're the light, and I want you to be on a stand where everybody can now see you. Well, that's scary. But Jesus is calling us to that, because this is what the kingdom of God looks like. So we get these two similar statements. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. And protect that. Put it right where people can see it. Go out, salt the world around, bring light to the world around. Don't hide it. So then he switches to this idea, well, how do we accomplish that? Okay, so if we're the salt and we're the light, how do we go and be those things? How do we make sure that we're not being complacent or that we're not hiding our light under something, but instead letting it shine fully? Verse 17, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but I have come to fulfill them. I have not come to abolish, but I have come to fulfill. The law is also known as the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible. So it's this history of the people of God, but it's also, we get the law, so we get things like the Ten Commandments, the Mosaic Law. And then we have the prophets. There's prophets throughout history, throughout the Old Testament, were the people that God chose to speak on behalf for him, to speak grace, truth, but also warning, say, hey guys, judgment is coming. The Lord is saying this, so don't get mad at me. But it's these prophets they say. So Jesus is saying, I've come to fulfill the law, and I've come to fulfill the prophets. At this point, the law and the prophets were the will of God. That's where the will of God was wrapped up, the law and the prophets. And Jesus is coming to say, I am going to fulfill those things. This portion of the text stands out from a lot of Jesus' teachings. Because not only is he saying, I'm going to fulfill, a little bit later, he's warning people not to go against these commandments. And this is very much different from a lot of his teachings, because a lot of his teachings is saying, don't just rely on the law, but I've come to bring new life, and that means a relationship with me. Jesus' greatest commandments are to love God and to love people. So we get all this other, it makes me think, why is Jesus saying this now? At this point in history, the Jews, the Lord's people, the people of Israel, were not to just observe the Torah, which is the law, the first five books of the Bible, but they also had what was known as the Mishnah, which was a commentary on the Torah, and then the Talmud, which was a commentary on the Mishnah, which was a commentary on the Torah. So what happened was you have the law of the Lord, and people were wanting to follow it, being strict about it. Well, then you have these people called scribes that wrote more laws to keep you from breaking those laws, and then again, they would write more laws to keep you from breaking those laws, which would keep you from breaking those laws. So there was all of these checkpoints, basically. So now there's all these thousands of laws that people that were not from the Lord, that the scribes wrote, that people were following. And this is what Jesus rejects. This sort of living. When we look at Jesus' ministry, he's constantly, between the scribes and the Pharisees, they're all mad at each other all the time. There's always conflict between Jesus, the scribes, and the Pharisees. And it's because Jesus has ushered in his kingdom, and it's not just about following the rules, but it's about a relationship with Jesus. So that's why Jesus rejects this. And so Jesus says he's come to fulfill the law and the prophets. He's saying that he's come to bring this real meaning behind the law, the real meaning of what the prophets have said, and that's a loving relationship with the Lord. Here, it's not about the rules, but it's about the heart of the rules, the heart of the commands, the intent of them. And that's a relationship with Jesus. When I was in seminary, our professor told us about this experiment that someone did with a herd of sheep. Didn't you know I raised sheep in high school randomly? And I don't know why. It sounded fun. I didn't have herds of sheep, but I had a couple sheep here and there that I would raise for stock shows. And anyway, they sheep are not real smart, I will say that. I did sheep and goats. Goats are way smarter than sheep. Anyway, this wasn't in my sermon. So they did this. They did this experiment on sheep to see how far sheep would go if they were just in a field. So they put out some alfalfa, because that's the good stuff, and the sheep would just stay around the alfalfa. There was no boundaries. The sheep were just right there. Well, then they decided to fence in the entire property, and they observed how far the sheep went then. Well, all of a sudden they noticed that the sheep were going to every single corner of the fence. They went way farther than when they didn't have any boundaries. And I love this illustration because I think it shows us the beauty and the freedom that we have in Christ when we know who we are. Because we have these commands and it seems like, well, Jesus, that's no fun. You know, we have these fences around us, but what it actually does is in that safety, in that confidence of who we are, this is who we are right here. This is who Jesus has created us to be. We find immense freedom because we don't have to worry of, oh man, I'm wondering if this was the boundary or if that was the boundary. At which point have I messed up or have I gone too far? And Jesus is saying, no, no, no. This is who you are. This is the kingdom of God. You're safe and you're free to live it out fully. So I love this illustration of the sheep because I do think it shows this beauty of the freedom that we find in knowing who we are in Jesus Christ. Verse 18 says, for truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. What Jesus is saying is that everything in the law is important. The first of the Ten Commandments says, there should be no other gods before me. Well, if that command, if we just decided, okay, that one's not important, let's throw it out, that unravels everything. Because if God is not our first and foremost, then what are we even doing here? Did you say every single one of these commandments are important? The ones that the Lord has given us. Not, we can't pick and choose. And he's saying until everything is accomplished, well what is accomplished? There's different ways to interpret this. Until the church abides by the spirit of the law, until the death and resurrection of Jesus, or until the second coming of Christ and he will reestablish his kingdom. I think all of these are true. But Jesus is saying that he's on the throne and it's his kingdom that reigns. Verse 19, therefore anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be least in the kingdom of heaven, but whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. There's a lot of times in Jesus' teachings where he's doing this. We even saw it in the Beatitudes, where there's this weakness versus strength going on, or the least versus the best, or the most, the last and the first. You know, he's even saying those who are last will be first in the kingdom of God. He flips it here because he's actually talking about the kingdom. And so he's saying those who teach against the law will be the least in the kingdom. And those who abide, who obey, and who teach obedience will be first in the kingdom of God, will be the most, will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. I think this shows the values that lie in the kingdom of God. When we look at Genesis, the serpent, when he's deceiving Adam and Eve, what he does is he puts doubt in their mind first. God told them, do not eat from this tree. And the serpent says, yeah, but did God really say that? Do you think he really said that? I think he really said this. But this is how the enemy deceives. And this, that's the first book in the Bible. That's just the first couple chapters. Right at the beginning, we see the enemy deceiving by putting doubt in people's minds. And the enemy does that today as well. It's easy to think, well, yeah, but did God really say that? Or did he really mean that? Or that doesn't really sound fun. Like, it's okay, just give into it a little bit. And Jesus is warning his people early on in the sermon to reject that, to watch out for it, because it's not the word of God. So here, the goal is not to be this perfect people, to follow the rules perfectly, but it's about orienting our lives so it points towards Jesus, to giving it this shot. Last week we looked at the Beatitudes, and the list seemed like a lot, which again showed us our need for grace. But Jesus is wanting us to follow his commands, not to be perfect, but just to look towards him, to look at the kingdom, to see what the kingdom is like. You should know this about me. I'm really bad at basketball. Just never been good. I'm not good at throwing things. I'm not good at catching things. I'm not good at aiming at things. And so my mom, she's a sideline coach, always has been since I was little. She is much louder than my actual coaches that I had. And something she would always tell me is, Hayley, you cannot score if you don't shoot. You can't win if you don't shoot. You can't, you just have to try. I'm like, well, I'm not going to make it. They're going to make fun of me. I'm scared. And she's like, you just have to do it. You just have to shoot the ball. Just try. Just, Hayley, just shoot the ball. Okay, you're really nervous, and I think Jesus is telling us that. Just try. I know that there's all these commands, but it's not about following them perfectly, but it's about looking at me and just trying. Let's try to be faithful people. And the only way that we can do that is through the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So verse 20, he says, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter in the kingdom of heaven. The Pharisees, this is what we know about the Pharisees, they were so proud because they were the people that followed the law perfectly. And the scribes, we talked about them earlier, they were so proud of themselves because they were the ones that interpreted the law perfectly. And the listeners to this sermon that Jesus was preaching on this mount, they were familiar with this. They looked at the Pharisees and the scribes and said, oh, they're very religious people. They're the religious leaders. They have their stuff together. And if we remember, Jesus and the Pharisees and the scribes were always battling each other. Because although they may look perfect on the outside, their souls were rotting on the inside. And so Jesus is saying, if your righteousness surpasses that. So even though they weren't perfect, people saw them as being these perfect followers of the law. And again, Jesus is showing us our need for grace. He's saying, if you're better than them, sure. But none of us have the ability to follow this law perfectly. Jesus is pointing to our undeniable need for grace. And our righteousness comes from Christ and Christ only. So we are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. And Jesus is the fulfillment of the law and prophets. They ask this question, how can the Sermon on the Mount be so fundamental and basic to Christian discipleship and yet so shockingly radical? How can it be simple and straightforward, yet so captivating? Charles Campbell reminds us this, that there's something bigger and indeed more startling at work here. He says the Sermon on the Mount offers us a vision of an alternative world that shocks us out of our very common sense, taken for granted assumptions, so that we might see the world differently and possibly glimpse the new creation that has come in Jesus Christ himself. The Sermon on the Mount is flipping everything upside down that people understand. That's the point. Because the kingdom of God is all about being faithful to Jesus and not living to the societal rules that we find ourselves in. This Sermon on the Mount, over and over again, is pointing to our need of a Savior, Jesus Christ, who's standing right in front of the crowd, who's standing right in front of us here, who's present with us here today, giving us this sermon, giving us his words. This is the kingdom that Jesus is ushering in, the kingdom where we are the salt, we are the light, and that he is the one who's in charge and guiding over this kingdom. Let's pray. Gracious and mighty God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you are a God that includes us in your kingdom, that includes us to be your hands and your feet to bring hope into the world, Lord. And we pray that we are people who respond, who hear your word, who hear, Lord, who have seen your sacrifice that you've given, that you've given us this opportunity to live freely and fully within, Lord, your kingdom. And the kingdom looks different than the world around us, and we are thankful for that, our Lord, because it's your kingdom of light, of hope, and joy. Lord, we love you, and we trust you, and thank you, thankful for your word, and we pray. Amen. Amen. During our final song, the prayer rooms are always open if you would like to come and pray. I'd love to pray with you. Thank you.
to help bring things for VBS. Also, sign up for VBS, whether it's your children or you want to volunteer. It's going to be a really great week in July. So please sign up. And would you go with this blessing? Lord, send us out to be your light in this world, to be your hope to all people. In your name we pray. Amen.